Several government agencies hold a simulation of a ransomware attack on an airport's information system as part of the Cybersecurity Awareness Month. Andrea Taguinas gives us a look.
What will you do when the airport's information system gets hit by a ransomware attack? Flight details get leaked.
Dapat confidential yung flight. Bakit nakabalandra na sa social media, na pupunta ako ng Greece bukas? Di ba dapat secret lang yun?
And the whole thing leads to a deadly collision of planes. That's what the cybersecurity teams of several government agencies had to figure out during a tabletop exercise organized by the Department of Information and Communications Technology as part of its activities for Cybersecurity Awareness Month. Participating groups were assigned different roles: airport management, airline, third-party service provider, aviation regulator, and data privacy watchdog.
We're trying to create scenarios which will train them how to properly react if there is a cybersecurity crisis. For example, basic questions like, when do they inform regulators? Next question is, at what stage do I inform my superiors, my general manager? Is there a need to inform? Is there a need to create a national emergency communications cluster for such crisis? Parang fire drill, but pag hindi mo pinapractice, pag nangyari, nagpapanik ka, like what happened sa PhilHealth.
DICT Undersecretary Jeffrey D said, while the DICT is always prepared to lend a hand to affected organizations, they should also have their own cybersecurity processes down pat.
Gusto kasi namin, hindi kami eh. Dapat sila mismo on the ground, on day zero, pag may nangyaring attack, they know how to handle it, they have the technology to handle it.
There was even a mock press conference to train government employees on crisis communication. Chofilo Arbeleta, who heads the Energy Regulatory Commission's Management and Information Systems Division, now wants to replicate the activity over at the ERC.
Mas nai-improve yung decision making pag may ganitong nangyaring incident. Anong gagawin mo? Sinong kukontakin mo? Sinong kakausapin mo? Sinong iko-coordinate mo?
In real life, D said the DICT will also arrange a meeting soon with the new operators of the Ninoy Aquino International Airport, the private consortium Nuna IA Infrastructure Corp, to discuss cybersecurity protocols.
We will need to communicate with them in the next few days about how we should interact with each other when a cybersecurity incident of that proportion happens.
Like airports, D said most of the other critical information infrastructures, or CIIs, in the Philippines are controlled by the private sector, such as telcos, power grids, and water supply systems. That's why the DICT continues to push for the cybersecurity bill, which would mandate operators of CIIs to report to the government when they get hit by a cyber attack. The agency expects the proposed measure to be passed by the start of the 20th Congress. But D said they would give firms up to 24 months to comply. Andrea Taguinas, ABS-CBN News.
A multi-million dollar loan has been approved to boost the digital infrastructure in the Philippines, which records around 2 million cyber threats per day. More from Jackie Pascual.
The Department of Information and Communications Technology reveals it is monitoring about 2 million cyber threats per day. Majority of these threats target government agencies as well as state colleges and universities and private businesses.
At any given day, approximately 2.1 million threats are being monitored by the National Security Operations Center. Not all of these threats are successful in attacking government or critical information infrastructures. 50% targets government, 30% targets academe, 80% na yun. 10% targets the telecommunications industry, so 90% na yun. The remaining 10% is usually banking or health sectors, etc.
The DICT now welcomes World Bank's board approval of a $287 million loan for the Philippine Digital Infrastructure Project. The World Bank says this will be invested in the government's national fiber optic backbone, connectivity infrastructure, to secure against cybersecurity threats and climate risks.
$43 million of that loan is for cybersecurity, building the capabilities of the National Security Operations Center and our National Computer Emergency Response Team.
Dee says the project will help expand internet access in the country, where internet penetration in the Philippines is at 73.6%, but in parts of Mindanao, it's just less than 20%. The World Bank adds this project is aimed to benefit Filipinos outside the country's main urban areas because current telecommunications services are mostly concentrated in key cities and towns. The DICT adds the economy also benefits with better internet penetration.
For every 10% increase in internet penetration rate, the gross domestic product increases by approximately 1.38%.
The World Bank says this loan can help 20 million Filipinos enjoy better internet services, bridging the digital divide, and unlock the full potential of the digital economy. Jackie Pascual, ABS-CBN News.
The Philippine Agriculture Department assures the public of sufficient rice supply following the rollout of the 43 peso rice in several Kadiwa stores in the country. Jervis Manahan reports.
The Agriculture Department on Friday rolled out cheaper rice for the public, starting in a Kadiwa store in Barangay Daang Bakal in Mandaluyong City. From 45 pesos per kilo, they lowered the price of rice to 43 pesos per kilo under the Rice for All program. This program aims to help all consumers get access to cheaper rice as price of the grain plummets in the world market. Agriculture Secretary Francisco D. Laurel said they did not have to shell out funds to subsidize the program, even if prevailing prices of commercial rice is still above 50 pesos.
Ang 43 pesos ay no subsidy. Ibig sabihin, yan yung presyo talaga na hindi malulugi ang gobyerno or Kadiwa. So yan ang presyo na kaya paikutin, hindi malulugi. Kaya hindi budo yan, hindi kalokohan yan.
Depending on the value of the Philippine peso, the agency said they might even pull it lower to 39 pesos per kilo by next year. Households say the program is helpful in making ends meet.
Malaking tipid po kasi ang bigas, 43 pesos po, kung sa labas po, nasa 60 or 50, ang pinakamura sa labas. E dito, 43 lang po. Malang laking tipid po kasi sa manambilihin po ngayon sa labas eh.
Malaking bagay yun kasi mahal ang bigas ngayon eh.
There is no limit to purchases of rice, but the department has an appeal to the public.
Pakiusap ko lang sa Rice for All na kahit walang limit, wag din naman abusuhin, baka bilhin dito ng mura, tapos ibenta naman din sa kabilang lugar ng mahal. So kung pwedeng panawagan sa tao na kung pwedeng for home consumption lang, wag gawing negosyo.
However, several agricultural groups blasted the program, saying this is not the right way to lower rice prices. But the program will continue, as the government says they already have enough stock of rice to sell until the first quarter of 2025. Jervis Manahan, ABS-CBN News.
On to more news now. Diesel and kerosene prices headed higher for the fourth straight week. Estimates show diesel price per liter could go up by as much as 2 pesos and 70 centavos, while that of kerosene could increase by up to 2 pesos and 60 centavos. Gasoline prices, meanwhile, could see an increase of up to 2 pesos and 60 centavos. A bombshell dropping during Friday's House probe into the alleged Duterte-era extrajudicial killings. A former police officer who once headed the state-run lottery agency claims ex-president Rodrigo Duterte instructed her to find a police officer who could execute his anti-drug campaign on a national scale. Ruina Garma said the drug crackdown was intended to replicate Davao City's approach, which allegedly rewarded policemen for the killing of drug suspects.
The Davao model involves three levels of payment of rewards. First is the reward if the suspect is killed. Second, if is the funding of planned operations. And the third is the refund of operational expenses.
A House lawmaker believes Garma is a credible resource person.
Medyo ako yung nagulat na. Nagbago na nga yung tenor ng kanyang mga sinasabi. Ano? Nahutuwa naman ako sapagkat finally, she was able to talk freely at sabihin niya talaga ang mga pangyayari na dapat na makita namin. Nakita niya rin yung mga bagay-bagay na dapat niya makita sa buhay niya. So, palagay ko naman, meron siyang credibility na sabihin yan.
Around 6,000 drug suspects were killed by police during the six-year term of President Duterte. But rights groups estimate the actual death toll to be as high as 12,000. Former President Rodrigo Duterte is set to be called in the next House Quad Committee hearing into the drug war. The former president has been accused of masterminding the drug war reward system. Duterte earlier said he is open to attending the House hearings with hopes lawmakers will ask him educated questions. One of the committee chairpersons, Manila Representative Benny Abante, says more information will be revealed in the QuadCom's next hearings.
Eh, papatawag din namin siya pagkat sinabi naman niya na he is willing to attend. Not yesterday dahil sa marami na kaming tinatawag at naihanda na namin lahat ng mga resource persons at masyado maskit. Pero pa kaming mga ilang mga i-reveal. They're now actually seeing the light. Pero na mismo ang nagkukusa na magbigay ng mga affidavit ko dyan.
A member of a joint Philippine congressional panel vouches for the credibility of the drug war testimony of ex-lottery official Ruyina Garma. Congressman Dan Fernandez believes Garma's revelations confirm speculations state personnel and funds were used in extrajudicial killings of drug suspects. He also notes Garma's testimony marked the first time former President Rodrigo Duterte and Senators Ronald De La Rosa and Christopher Bongo were linked to the summary killings. Fernandez, who heads the House Public Order and Safety Committee, guarantees Garma's safety after her revelations.
This is something that is big. Coming from a former PCSO general manager and at the same time being a former COP of Davao and being close to the president is something that strengthened the position of those issues or news about the killings being paid. Dito, you can somehow put a much strengthened foundation. If before, parang mga news lang yon, but this time, ano eh, parang it was cemented already. Eh, that the EJK with reward system really happened in the past administration. Being a part of our custody, the sergeant at arms, we have this responsibility to protect her at all cost. And that's the reason why we are contemplating on not allowing yet to lift the contempt that we have cited on her, precisely on the reason of her security.
Senator Ronald De La Rosa, the Duterte administration's former police chief, denies the existence of a reward system for cops in connection with the anti-drug war. In a message to ABS-CBN News, De La Rosa said he knows nothing about the scheme. He added he had no funds to execute the alleged reward system during his time as PNP chief. He also insisted there is no need for a reward system as it is the sworn duty of every policeman to keep his area of responsibility free from drugs. Former Police Colonel Ruyina Garma said before lawmakers Friday, police officers received 20,000 to as much as 1 million pesos for killing drug personalities. Senator Bongo calls for an investigation into the allegations of retired police Colonel Ruyina Garma, who implicated former President Duterte in the extrajudicial killings of drug suspects. The senator says Garma's statements during the House hearing are merely diversionary tactics to muddle the true issue that she is facing, which is her participation in an alleged murder plot. Go adds malicious and unsubstantiated statements would have no place in any credible investigation. 17 foreigners arrested after the National Bureau of Investigation raided a suspected scam hub in Makati City on Friday. The suspects were mostly Chinese nationals who were believed to be engaged in investments and cryptocurrency scams. Authorities recovered computers, cell phones, and various SIM cards, including a script allegedly used to defraud victims. The NBI says the suspects were staying in one apartment building. Philippine President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. is back home after attending the ASEAN Summit in Laos, PDR. In his arrival statement Friday, Mr. Marcos said the Philippines will continue to defend its sovereignty and jurisdiction in the West Philippine Sea. He adds Manila will continue to strengthen its partnerships with countries who are committed to peace and the rule of law. Marcos also revealed the leaders of ASEAN agreed to work together to promote sustainable agriculture and tourism. In fact, next week, the Philippines will host the Asia-Pacific Ministerial Conference on Disaster Risk Reduction to help mitigate the devastating effects of climate change. President Marcos also explains why Vice President Sara Duterte was not named as the country's caretaker when he left for the ASEAN summit. Marcos said it will be unfair to assign Duterte since she is no longer part of his cabinet. The task fell on Executive Secretary Lucas Bersamin, Justice Secretary Jesus Crispin Remulla, and Agrarian Reform Secretary Conrado Estrella III.
She's not part of the really the day-to-day running of what we are doing. So it would be unfair to ask her to now suddenly to impose that duty on her, since that's not part of her work now. It's a very practical reason, actually. That's how I came to that conclusion. If you notice, the membership of the executive committee are all part of that. They're all members of the cabinet up to now. So that would seem to be the obvious way to handle it.
Japan vows closer cooperation with the Philippines amid tensions in the Indo-Pacific region. This commitment made by its new Prime Minister, Ishiba Shigeru, in a meeting with Philippine President Ferdinand Marcos at the sidelines of the ASEAN summit. The readout of the meeting said the two leaders agreed to improve bilateral relations in an increasingly challenging regional security environment. Also on the table was the potential early enforcement of a defense pact signed by Marcos and then Premier Fumio Kishida in July. Marcos and Ishiba further discussed cooperation on economic security and agricultural technology. Still on geopolitical tensions, Beijing reiterates its opposition to the U.S. deployment of a missile system in the Philippines. The Chinese Foreign Ministry said Friday the presence of offensive strategic weapons at other countries' doorsteps threatens peace and stability in the region. Beijing also urged relevant parties to recognize the sensitivity of the issue and oppose what it calls attempts to stoke an arms race in the region. The missile system was brought in by the U.S. in April for the two nations' military drills. The Philippine defense chief earlier said Manila is not engaging in an arms race, but focused on boosting its defense capabilities.